week, or if they work there, or within 48 hours, is no longer. We feel very confident in that going forward. Our numbers look really good. For Oahu, you know, we've now given out over 2 million vaccines of our eligible population. 38% or 375,000 of those have been boosters. Our hospitalizations, as of our last report, are under 100. Our COVID cases, our ICU and ventilated cases are down in low single digits. So all in, that time has finally come. And so I wanted to make it really absolute clear, because I think there's been some real confusion. I watched the report last night that people were talking about restrictions involving weddings, and I don't understand that. So right now, there are no further restrictions by the city and county as it relates to COVID. So that said, that's the purpose of today. So I just want to emphasize this. I want to thank the people of Oahu. What we have been through together over the last 2 years has been a battle. And the people of our island have fought back bravely against this. And as the numbers reflect, everybody has done everything that they possibly could to demonstrate a genuine concern for taking care of themselves, their families, and the greater good, each other, and all of us. I am so proud of the way Hawaii came through this COVID experience. We were tested and tested and tested, and the resiliency of our people was terrific. That's a really great credit to who we are as a people and everything that we talk about with respect to the feeling of spirit of aloha, our sense of ohana, and our sense of knowing full well that as island dwellers, we owe a lot to each other and how we deal with life. And this was an incredible test, and everybody came through really well. So with that, I'll take any questions that anybody might have. And I also am pleased to have Dr. Jim Island in the room today, and Ian Santi from EMS. And if there's any questions in that regard, I'll be happy to refer them. But go ahead.
Hi, good morning, Mayor. You know, I know you said that there are no further restrictions in regard to COVID-19 for the city going forward. What can you say in regard to the city's vaccine mandate for city employees?
Okay, the city's vaccine mandate comes under the governor's emergency proclamation. So he said state and city and county employees, and so we can't change that. We're going to see tomorrow, I believe the governor is having a press conference, and he'll be making those announcements at that time. But that was one of the things we were not able to change or was in our jurisdiction to make that call.
Would that also apply to the indoor mask mandate as well?
Well, that's going to be up to the governor as well. That indoor mask mandate belongs to him. But I want to say something about the mask mandate in anticipation of that. As I look at a bunch of reporters with their mask on, you know, I understand this burning question, and I understand that a lot of people appear to be annoyed over the fact that we still have a mask mandate in place. Yet, now look, I don't talk to everybody in the world, but as I go outside knowing full well that we haven't had a mask mandate in place for months, I still see people wearing masks, the vast majority, other than in Waikiki, outside wearing masks. And I've been polling people lately about the mask mandate, asking them, and most people have said, you know what, I think I still may wear my mask. I mean, let's not forget the fact that COVID killed 6 million people. And 400 million people went to hospitals. They were not hospitals, but they were sickened by it. Okay? There's a lot of residual fear. So I'm hoping that maybe, I can't speak for the governor and the Department of Health, but if they do that, that maybe they'll just say it'll be optional. And let people transition out of this disease. Because I'm not so sure if they said we have no more mask mandate, that you wouldn't see people wearing masks anyway. So that's where I am on that.
Good morning, Mayor. Max Cachalan here.
Hello, Max. Thanks for identifying yourself. I would have known it was you. Go ahead.
Okay, great. You know, what's the message for business owners out there, you know, who are used to, who may hear a loosening of restrictions, but then months later, there's restrictions introduced because of variants or high cases. So how should they receive this news today?
Well, look, Max, first thing I can't do is predict the future. If I could do that, it would be a very different deal, okay? But we haven't had restrictions affecting businesses and restaurants now for some time. In fact, you go back to December 23rd, when we were having some pretty good numbers happening at Omicron. I went out and had a press conference with all of you, and I said, we're not going to impose any further restrictions other than the maintenance of Safe Access Oahu. And we went through some pretty tough weeks during the month of January, but we held to that. We've tried to keep our businesses open and without imposing those restrictions now for quite some time. As far as the future, none of us know. If you listen to the health experts, they'll tell you with the critical mass of people who've been vaccinated, the numbers of people who've contracted the disease, the nature of diseases, I think we're in for a good run on a going forward basis, and we'll just have to see what the future brings.
Thank you, Mayor.
Okay.
Can you give us specifics on how you're going to sunset the restrictions till March 5th?
Well, I'm not going to sunset restrictions until March 5th. On March 5th, the last restriction that we have had in place, which is Safe Access Oahu, will sunset. So that's the only, right now, there are no other restrictions from the city and county under our emergency order. Okay?
What does this mean for county, city and county testing sites? Will there be a ramp down for the amount of, you know, testing offered through this, all the free ones that the city has set up in reaction to that?
Yeah, that's a good question. Right now, we have no plans to lighten up on the testing sites, but I suspect that we will. Just like, since nobody's asking me, I'll tell you that ISOQ at Westlock, I think, ends tomorrow. We'll still keep that facility available if needed, and we have Harbor Arms as an ISOQ facility through the end of March, for the entire month of March. You know, I'm going to say it again. We want to transition out of this, even though we're letting our emergency order sunset, that we understand that COVID's not over, okay? But we're going to go forward in living with this disease, and we'll try to act as responsibly as we can as a city organization, putting our health and welfare of our people first. And so those kinds of decisions, we will ease into it.
And then can you also reiterate what opportunities there might be for businesses who are suffering financially during COVID?
Well, there's a lot of different, you know, federal monies that might be available on opera relief monies and different things like that. It's just a matter of how people qualify. I think our Department of Economic Revitalization is a place where people can apply for those kinds of reimbursements. Our Office of Economic Revitalization, OER.
Mayor, you've appeared with quite a few public health experts from across Hawaii's health systems in past pressers. Have you consulted them, and what do they think of ending the vaccine or test mandate?
They feel the same way. I've been in consultation. I didn't bring them here today because this is pretty much just a joyous announcement, if you will, and it's a matter-of-fact announcement. But I would say this, just so everybody knows, throughout the entire ordeal, I stand very proud and very confident about the calls we made throughout COVID from the time that we came into office, slugging our way all the way through the tier system, only to run into Delta, and what we had to do with Delta and how nimble we were, and that actually gave rise to Safe Access Oahu, and then the decisions we made involved with Omicron. But all of those decisions were in serious consultation with our leading healthcare professionals, including infectious disease specialists from the mainland as well. So we talked with a lot of people, and I think that, you know, we took the broader definition of public health. The Department of Health focuses on the health issue. We have a broader responsibility in governing, right? We had the public health issues involving the increase in domestic violence and suicides and in divorces and all kinds of depression and all kinds of other things. We also had to take into account businesses that were closing, the anguish that came with that, and the resources. I'm very proud of what our department OER did with respect to rent and utility relief monies, and I really believe that we mitigated much of what might have happened in the way of evictions once the governor lists the eviction notice, because we were very instrumental in providing now well over $140 million to more than 13,000 families, and that's ongoing. So we've approached it that way. Yes, there was the disease, the decision-making related to the disease, but our decision-making was broader than that, and that's the responsibility of this office.
Mm-hmm. One more question. So we've been surprised with surprise variants in the past, Delta and Omicron. Are you leaving a window open to possibly reinstate Safe Access sometime in the future?
I think the window that we have open is the fact that we now know a lot more than we ever knew 2 years ago. And we are prepared at any time to take whatever action necessary, whatever that condition should bring. If you remember correctly, going back just 2 years ago, when people started first hearing about a pandemic, it was almost in disbelief. It was hard to fathom what that even meant. Now that we've had 2 years of this, the window that's been open is a great experience that we've been through and how much we've learned from it and what our capabilities are.
Hi, Mayor. With the emergency order sunsetting March 5th,
yes.
Private businesses, do they still have the opportunity to impose their own COVID restrictions?
That's a good question. You know, I think if the private businesses decide that they want to do that for the safety of their patrons, then I don't think we can restrict them from doing that. I think we're going to actually, that's a really good question. I think we're going to, as I was saying earlier about the optional face mask, I think we're going to transition from this more in a gradual way. And I think people need to be respectful of that. From the standpoint, I like to say sometimes in life I've learned that people do a couple things very differently. The older I've gotten, the more I respect that. One, they grieve differently. I don't judge people about how they grieve, because everybody has a different reaction to a circumstance, and you can't project that. And the other is how they fear. And if anything, COVID has brought out a lot of fear in people. I want to stay very sensitive to that fear. So I think it's going to be incumbent upon anybody running a business to keep their patrons comfortable and to make that call as to whether or not they think that's the responsible thing to do. And I think we're going to ease into it.
In regards to the mask mandate, which of course is under the governor, what would you like to say to people who are pointing out that we're the only state with a statewide mask mandate right now?
I'm sorry, I missed your question. I was just handed a note. Please, if you don't mind, repeat that.
And the mask mandate is, of course, under the governor.
Right.
But what would you like to say to people who are in your county that are arguing the fact that we're the only state with one in place?
Well, I'm going to say it again. I see a preponderance of people wearing masks outdoors, and we haven't had an outdoor mask mandate for a number of months. So, you know, whether we're last or first in the country, we also happen to have the best, if I'm not mistaken, I think we're second only in deaths per capita to Vermont, and we're lowest in the country in the disease, infectious disease per capita, right? So Hawaii has done an outstanding job. And so in those cases, we were first, and now we're last with the mask mandate. I just was handed a note, just so you know, that the state is confirming that the indoor mask mandate, they're going to continue it, and they're going to make an announcement in the future after evaluation of CDC guidelines and the state county metrics. I just got that news release here, so you're hearing it from me. I guess I can speak on behalf of the state. That was Sam Mocha, chief of staff. So I don't think you're going to see the indoor mask mandate go away. But I'm going to say it again. We're so focused on being the last in the country, yet we have metrics that have us as the best in the country with respect to how many people died and how many people got sick here. So, you know, let's keep that in context. That's all behind us. Let's go forward.
I have a question for Dr. Ireland. Dr. Mayor alluded to this, where we are in terms of case counts and vaccines and hospitalizations. Could you discuss what you're seeing from a medical capacity right now and what Honolulu's medical infrastructure has been facing in recent weeks?
Sure. I'm James Ireland, Director of Honolulu Emergency Services Department. We're in a really good spot now with respect to COVID. Today on Oahu, there's 55 people in the hospital. And of those 55, 7 are in the ICU. And this has been a drop we've seen over the last few weeks. With respect to the city, we took over isolation quarantine in the beginning of the year. In January, 100% of our quarantine beds were filled. Today, it's right around 25% of our quarantine beds are filled. So case counts are going down, and we're seeing that, you know, proportional decreases in the hospitalizations, in the ICU stays, and also in our quarantine use. I've said all along, and we've discussed all along, that someday we will be able to treat COVID like we treat the flu, meaning get a vaccine, stay home if you're sick, cover your mouth. And I never knew when that day would come, but I think it is coming soon, which is good news with respect to just how we behave and how we, you know, act in society. But I think this experience has also taught us a lot about staying home when you're sick. You know, a lot of people haven't done that in the past, even with the flu. So I think behaviors have changed. You know, basically, I've worn a 95 mask for 2 years. Not the same one, I'll have you. And I'm going to still continue to do so if I'm in high-risk situations. But it's now, it's personal responsibility, it's personal preference. There was a time when I wouldn't even stand close to somebody like this without a mask on. But now that I'm vaccinated and boosted, I feel more comfortable doing that. But again, if I'm going into crowds, especially into Waikiki and stuff, I'll probably still wear this for a little while. I was fortunate, you know, I didn't get COVID. I test for it regularly. I've been boosted. So I feel like I've done everything I can to protect myself. And people who ask my opinion on what they should do personally, I share that with them freely. It's a personal decision what people want to do. But I feel very good about the direction the city's moving in. I go to restaurants and they're full. It's fun to see people out again. One other thing I'll add is we do know that the access to care has changed over the last 2 years. Many people did video visits with their doctors, visits over the phone or telemedicine rather than in person. And some people just didn't get care because they were scared. Other people, you know, because of the economic changes and job losses, you know, in the beginning, lost their insurance. So we're seeing now the hospitals are actually busier, and even our EMS calls are busier with non-COVID calls. Problems with blood pressure, with diabetes, heart attacks, strokes. So unfortunately, those type of medical conditions are, it's busy right now, especially for EMS. The call counts are up every day. But partially, I think that's because people maybe didn't get optimal care over the last 2 years because of they were afraid or they didn't go see their doctors. So that's all catching up a little now. But you know, in general, the hospitals, I'm not seeing overly reroute. We're seeing still a little bit. But they're not, I would say, overwhelmed, and certainly not with COVID. So I think it's all moving in the right direction. So that's kind of a long-winded answer to your question, but that's how I feel.
Yeah, so similarly, can you talk, you mentioned a little bit about the blood pressure, strokes, people calling in for that, but are you saying also that you're not seeing as many calls for COVID-related symptoms to EMS? And then also, I know that EMS was kind of overloaded about 2 months ago. How has that kind of been too?
So EMS really, you know, I just can't be prouder of them and what they've done. You know, in the beginning, they responded to all the COVID calls. Sometimes there are some points in this pandemic where every single call was a COVID call during a couple of the different spikes. Huge amount of PPE, you know, sweating, hot, you know, having to clean and disinfect the ambulance between all those calls. So they've done a great, you know, heroic job. But now they aren't going on a lot of COVID calls. They are still going on some, but not a lot, and that's a great thing. So every day they'll get a few. I see on the 911 board, person with a fever, may or may not be vaccinated, or someone who'd had a positive COVID test now is having a little trouble breathing. Unfortunately, we're still going to calls where people are sick who have not been vaccinated, amazingly. But that call volume is way, way, way down. Ian, what would you say our overall call volume is up, about 50 to 100 911 calls a day?
Back to normal, yeah.
Yeah, so we're at pre-pandemic levels for 911 calls or a little busier. The other thing is the visitor industry is robust. And so we have calls in Waikiki for people who are visiting who get sick. And then the other thing is people are, I think, outdoors and enjoying themselves more than ever, which is a good thing. But with all these people hiking, spending time in the oceans, and just doing outdoor recreation, that's generating a lot of calls. You know, we're going on a fire department with the fire department on rescues, maybe not every day, but more frequently than before. Ocean safety is very busy in the ocean, and we have extended hours now, so their rescues are very busy. And then we're also seeing like Kahuku Motocross Track, we're going there. So it's the stuff we always do in EMS and ocean safety, but maybe a little more.
This one's for Mayor. You mentioned that the Westlock facility, quarantine facility, would be closing. Is there any ETA on when people will be able to start moving in there for the permanent affordable housing?
I don't have that date, but we'd like to do that sooner rather than later. We purposely set that up for our homeless situation, and it's really a great facility. So I think sooner rather than later, we want to get on with our lives. I want to add one other thing. I really appreciate Dr. Allen being here and his perspective. In fact, when I talk about consulting with the medical community, you should know Jim is one of the first guys I speak to, because he's not only feet on the ground, he's got great hands-on operational experience with this. But I hope that whatever the concerns may be over the mask mandate doesn't overshadow, if you will, where we are at this moment in time. And the fact that we have no restrictions, that everything is ready, people are able to go back and live their lives, albeit if we're wearing a mask indoors when appropriate. But other than that, you know, our community for the last 2 years has fought back bravely, I'll say it again, and very diligently. If you look at our percentage of vaccinations, you know, just so you know, 87% of the people of Oahu have had at least one shot. 80% have had second, and 38% of 375,000 people have had a booster. Those are, you know, in the aggregate, that's over 2 million vaccines for a population, eligible population, well under a million people. That is a tremendous turnout. That is one of the reasons why I think our numbers are what they are with respect to the number of people who died, and for that matter, the number of people who were sick on a per capita basis. It's been a great job by the community and all of our public health people. I would be remiss not acknowledging the EMS, but how about all the healthcare workers in all of our hospitals and how they responded? They did a tremendous job. This is a time right now and a moment to be joyous. out of community pride and community spirit for each other, and I really hope that that comes across in how you choose to cover this press conference. Mark, anything else?
Mayor, sorry to do this, but I have a question on a different topic.
Yeah, you do. Different topic? Okay, are we done with COVID, though? Okay, look, I'm here. I'll answer any questions you want to have on anything, and if I don't want to answer, I'll tell you about it.
It is a significant issue. Right now, crews are on the North Shore responding to a home that collapsed along the coastline. Do you feel that more could have been done to regulate building in that area?
That's a good question. You know, I saw the picture of that this morning. It was obviously high, big waves coming in, right? Everything we've been talking about in the Office of Climate Change, Sustainability, and Resilience has a lot to do with the shoreline setbacks that are about to go in. You know, some of this stuff, and I looked at that home this morning, like Jim Ireland sent me that at what, 5 o'clock this morning or 6 o'clock this morning. You know, some of this stuff has been built, it was built some time ago, and we know we have sea level rise. So we're going to go through that process, Mark. It's going to take a while. There are different things that we're going to be asking in shoreline management. That's the best I can tell you.
Yeah, but would you be in favor of, you know, an increased...
I think we have to be in favor, regrettably, of what's happened with the world. And I say regrettably because climate change is real. Sea level rise is definitely real, and we're island dwellers to begin with. So we want to do that smartly. It's going to take time. It's not inexpensive to do. But we're focused on doing that. I can assure you that.
So on that specific incident, what kind of response does the city provide now that this happened?
Well, I really don't know. I mean, you know, does anybody want to add to that? I mean, I
talk a little bit.
Yeah.
So first of all, the call came in about 1 in the morning. The story was is that some people heard some crashing and 911 was activated. So the initial response for life safety was Honolulu Fire Department. My understanding was the house was unoccupied, and at least I didn't get reports of any injuries. EMS didn't respond. When a house like this moves off its foundation in a significant manner, the concerns initially, number one, is anyone trapped or hurt? But beyond that is the electrical system compromised? Is the gas, is there a gas line, water lines? And the fire department generally will secure that in partnerships with the gas company or HECO or other city resources. At daybreak, the ocean safety lieutenant who works in that district did go to the scene. And from my department, from the ocean safety standpoint, they want to look for beach hazards. Is there glass, debris, wood, nails on the beach that a beachgoer could step on? So that really is the ocean safety response to look, you know, at the beach side and are there any immediate threats that could injure somebody. You know, yellow tape was put up. DLNR, I believe, was responding. But a number of city agencies, with the lead agency being the Department of Emergency Management, are involved. You know, other potential city agencies are involved as well. But again, like the mayor said, you know, this has happened before. Unfortunately, it'll probably happen again. But the main thing is we want to make sure is nobody is immediately hurt.
Does that answer your question? Because that is the immediate response, and I appreciate that. I thought I took the context of mean what are we going to do about it sort of afterwards, if you will. But I think everything in an emergency situation was done, as Jim said. But on a going forward basis, if that's what you meant, I'm not sure what we'll do. You know, I mean, from that standpoint, other than what I just said about our shoreline management and the way of the future, really, quite honestly.
Okay, thank you.
Okay. Anyone else? So, hey, sir? Okay, what's your name?
I'm Joel Lau, Honolulu Civil Beat.
Nice to meet you, Joe. All right, so let me just close by saying once again, first of all, in our press announcement today, we talked about the Royal Hawaiian Band coming back. They're going to be in full play. Really proud of, you know, Clark Bryce has done a great job, and our band has been out there, but they got reunited. And it comes at a good time, because I really do want to close this meeting with telling you this is a joyous moment right now. We were hoping this day would come, and even though it's not quite March 5th, we're there. As Jim just said, our hospitals are down. That was the one thing we've been concerned about over the last several months. I said that throughout various press conferences. We're going to focus on the hospital metrics. And fortunately, we were able to get through that well, and we're in good shape, and everybody should feel really good. Let's get on with our lives. Thank you very much.